Recorded Books and RB Digital present Lies Across America, What Our Historic Sites Get Wrong, by James W. Loewen. Narrated by L.J. Ganser. Dedicated to the memory of the heroes portrayed in this book, feet of clay and all, whose examples may yet inspire this nation to live out the meaning of its beliefs, and to the activists and scholars whose numbers are increasing, who work to get our public history to become more accurate, so our society can become more just. Preface to the second edition. What a difference 2 decades have made. When the first edition of Lies Across America came out, some people considered it outlandish. To include an appendix that called for monuments to be toppled, to say that the signs at the edge of towns noting first settled are off by thousands of years, to defend the vandalism of a statue in New Mexico, to suggest that Richmond has its history precisely backward, that it should celebrate rather than mourn its liberation by U.S. troops in April 1865. Today, these ideas have become, if not mainstream, at least commonplace. The SCV, Sons of Confederate Veterans, and UDC, United Daughters of the Confederacy, which looked as solidly influential in 1999 as the bronze and granite of their monuments, now seem feeble. Even then, new forces were at work. I wrote in 1999 that our landscape was contested. States were beginning to put up markers for embarrassing events, not just comforting ones. And now, reactionary white supremacist monuments are beginning to tumble. Even Monument Avenue in the Citadel of the Confederacy is no longer safe, not even after the addition of tennis great Arthur Ashe cleansed it of its sin of racial exclusivity. Over the last 20 years, Lies Across America has become the country's consistently best-selling book in public history, the discipline that studies monuments, markers, museums, and the like. The book has been explicitly cited by, among others, New Orleans Mayor Mitch Landrieu as influencing his thinking about monuments and has played some role in the changes that are now upending the field. My intention in creating this completely revised second edition is not only to bring the book up to date, noting the ongoing changes and how they occurred, but also to provide readers with examples of how they might do likewise. As I ended the first edition, this is our country, after all, our narrative, and our landscape upon which to tell it. Go be a troubadour. In what ways were we warped? When I was a boy, on our annual summer vacation trips, the family car seemed to stop at every historic marker and monument. Maybe yours did, too. Dad thought it was good for us, and I suppose, in a way, it was. Little did he suspect that it was also bad for us, that the lies we encountered on our trips across the United States subtly distorted our knowledge of the past and warped our view of the world. My sister and I needed to unlearn the myths we were learning in school, but the historic sites we visited only amplified them and taught us new ones. My bestseller, Lies My Teacher Told Me, tells how American history, as taught in most high schools, distorts the past and turns many students off. One result is that only 1 American in 6 ever takes a course in American history after graduating from high school. Where, then, do Americans learn about the past? From many sources, of course. Historical novels, PBS series, but surely, most of all, from the landscape. History is told on the landscape all across America, on monuments at the courthouse, by guides inside antebellum homes, and aboard historic ships, by the names we give to places, and on roadside historical markers. This book examines the history that some of these places tell and the processes by which they come forward to tell it. Markers, monuments, and preserved historic sites usually result from local initiative, typically a private organization, the Chamber of Commerce, a church congregation, the local chapter of the United Daughters of the Confederacy takes the lead. But public monies are usually involved before it's unveiled. It follows that the site will tell a story favorable to the local community, and particularly to that part of the community that erected or restored it. An account from another point of view might be quite different and also more accurate. Americans like to remember only the positive things, and communities like to publicize the great things that happened in them. One result is silliness. The first airplane was invented not by the Wright brothers, but by Reverend Burrell Cannon, and the first flight was not in Kitty Hawk, North Carolina, but in Pittsburgh, Texas. It must be true. An impressive-looking Texas State Historical Marker, Chapter 38, says so. Meanwhile, Georgia, Massachusetts, and Rhode Island all claim the first use of anesthesia. And markers in Brunswick, Georgia, and Brunswick County, Virginia, battle over where Brunswick stew was born. A more important result is racism. People who put up markers and monuments and preserve historic houses are usually pillars of the white community. The spate of Martin Luther King Jr. avenues and monuments in the 1970s and 1980s notwithstanding, Americans still live and work in a landscape of white supremacy, especially in the South, but all across America, even on black college campuses, Chapter 47. Markers, monuments, and names on the landscape glorify those who fought to keep African Americans in chains, as well as those who, after Reconstruction, worked to make them second-class citizens again. In 1999, when this book first came out, readers were amazed to learn that the person who got the most historical markers in any state was not Lincoln in Illinois or Washington in Virginia, but Nathan Bedford Forrest, Confederate cavalry general and first national leader of the Ku Klux Klan in Tennessee. Moreover, those white Southerners, misguided enough not to be racist, were ignored entirely or converted into good white Southerners when remembered. Thus, Helen Keller's birthplace, Chapter 49, flew a Confederate flag, while the real Keller was an early supporter of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, NAACP. Other monuments expressed white domination over Native Americans. A later introductory essay, Hieratic Scale in Historic Monuments, shows how sculptors typically place Native Americans physically lower than European Americans on historic monuments. Whites always wound up in positions of power and action, while people of color were passive on the bottom. Lame Deer, a Dakota leader, sees the same message in the four European-American faces carved on Mount Rushmore. These big white faces are telling us, first, we gave you Indians a treaty that you could keep these black hills forever, as long as the sun would shine, in exchange for all the Dakotas, Wyoming, and Montana. Then we found the gold and took this last piece of land because we were stronger, and there were more of us than there were of you, and because we had cannons and Gatling guns. And after we did all this, we carved up the mountain, the dwelling place of your spirits, and put our four gleaming white faces here. We are the conquerors. The language at historic sites is also warped. All across the country, Americans call Native Americans by tribal names that are wrong, and even derogatory. According to these histories on the landscape, Indians are savage, whites discover everything, and some causes portrayed as stainless today were drenched in blood in their own time. Then there is the matter of who gets memorialized and who gets left out. All too often, memorials heroify people who should not be forgotten, but who should never have been commemorated. Jeffrey Amherst, for example, who initiated germ warfare in the Americas, and for whom Amherst College and Amherst, Massachusetts are named, Chapter 85. Across America, the landscape has commemorated those men and women who opposed each agonizing next step our nation took on the path toward freedom and justice, while the courageous souls who challenged the United States to live out the meaning of its principles have lain forgotten or even reviled. Markers and monuments in many states left out women, sometimes so totally as to be unwittingly hilarious. As of the millennium, the only white woman to get a historical marker in Indiana, Chapter 30, to take one offending state, got remembered for coming into the state minus a body part she lost in Kentucky. Kentucky, meanwhile, erected, the right word, a female Civil War horse, chapter 32, with an extra body part that turns her into a male. As the preface to this new edition noted, however, a new era has begun to dawn. Virginia is putting up statues of 12 female history makers on the lawn of its capital, exactly equaling the number of men already memorialized there. New York's Central Park is about to get Susan B. Anthony and Elizabeth Cady Stanton. Previously, the park's only women were Mother Goose, Alice in Wonderland, and Juliet, along with some anonymous angels and dancers, compared to about 50 statues of men. In 1999, historic sites routinely covered up or lied about the sexual orientations of people if those orientations were gay or lesbian. Sex lives in general were off-limits. In the late 1990s, when historian Richard Schenkman asked a tour guide at Franklin D. Roosevelt's family mansion in Hyde Park, New York, about Roosevelt's mistresses, she told him, "The guides are specifically forbidden from talking about this." By 2019, we seem to have moved from flat denial to, "If asked, we'll tell." Just as Don't Ask, Don't Tell proved an unstable resting point for the armed forces in the first decade of this millennium, I think many historic sites are about to make further changes in this regard. In 2016, President Obama designated the Stonewall Inn in Greenwich Village a national monument to recognize how its 1969 riot sparked the gay rights movement in New York City and nationally. The National Register of Historic Places took in a row house in Washington, D.C., because it housed the Furies Collective, a lesbian group that led the debate over lesbians' place in American society, according to the National Park Service. So we may be moving toward a public history that recognizes sites because of their gay or lesbian history, quite a remove from denial. Another form of omission still takes place at historic homes, which often do not take their own history seriously enough to bother to tell it like it was. Instead of telling visitors what happened to the people who lived and worked there, guides prattle on about what the guests ate and the silverware they used. Guides almost always avoid negative or controversial facts, and most monuments, markers, and historic sites omit any blemishes that might taint the heroes they commemorate, making them larger and less interesting than life. High school history textbooks do the same thing. Presidents especially must be perfect. Woodrow Wilson's house in Washington, D.C. says nothing negative about the man who segregated the federal government. A temporary exhibit even credited him with supporting women's suffrage, which he opposed. Even Franklin Pierce, arguably our least popular president, is lauded by the historical marker in his hometown, Chapter 88. But inventing blemish-free heroes has never really worked. High school students don't really buy that the founding fathers were flawless, so they don't think of them as heroes to emulate, even when they were. Instead, they conclude that history textbooks are dishonest. Similarly, adult Americans don't really believe that their exalted forebears were as perfect as their monuments claim. I have watched tourists grow passive while guides tell them quaint stories about dead presidents. They don't know enough to ask about what's being left out, and the social situation doesn't encourage visitors to ask substantive questions, so they just traipse from room to room on automatic pilot. A critical question to ask at any historic site is, what does it leave out about the people it treats as heroes? A special form of these omissions still occurs at war museums, most of which present war without anguish, and instead focus genially on its technology. The battleship museum USS Intrepid in New York City mostly leaves out the Vietnam War, too political for its board of directors, Chapter 82. Omissions such as this can be hard to detect, especially for visitors who come to a site to learn a little history without bringing some knowledge of the site with them. People don't usually think about images that aren't there. And some images don't exist anywhere. Pay attention to what they tell you to forget, poet Muriel Rukeyser once wrote. And this book does. Nowhere have I seen portrayed the multicultural nature of pioneer settlements, where Native Americans, European Americans, and often African Americans lived and worked together, sometimes happily. Only a few obscure markers, one each in Utah, Colorado, Louisiana, and Michigan, and two in South Carolina, offer any mention of the trade in Indian slaves that started in 1513, and continued in some places at least until the Emancipation Proclamation in 1863. Yet enslaved natives were a feature of life in New York City, Charleston, Detroit, and other cities. All across America, the landscape suffers from amnesia, not about everything, but about many crucial events and issues of our past. When the landscape does not omit unpleasant stories entirely, it often tells them badly, even by the mediocre standards set by U.S. history textbooks. Except for the Chief Van House, a state historic site in Georgia, historic sites and museums in the United States rarely depict Native American farms, frame houses, or schools, compared to the enormous number of teepees on display. Thus, they portray American Indians as mobile and romantic, even when they weren't. Chapter 23. What tourists learn about slavery by visiting most historic sites, Chapter 69, is trifling compared to the more accurate information that current textbooks provide to high school students. On Reconstruction, that period after the Civil War when the federal government tried to guarantee equal rights for African Americans, the landscape is almost silent. Most sites that do mention it present a gone-with-the-wind version of black bad behavior that never happened. Chapter 43. Until the opening of the Montgomery Lynching Memorial in 2018, our landscape displayed little trace of the lynchings and race riots that swept the United States between 1890 and 1940, the nadir of race relations. All across America, monuments to the Spanish-American War, which was over in 3 months, are inscribed 1898 to 1902. Few visitors realize that those dates refer to the larger and longer Philippine-American War, which otherwise has mostly vanished from the landscape and from our historical memory. Chapter 25. The antithesis of omission is overemphasis, and the history written on the American landscape is largely the history of the federal governments, the United States of America and the Confederate States of America, and particularly of their wars. We infer much of what we know about the ancient Mayans and Egyptians from their public sculptures and monuments. What will archaeologists ages hence infer about us? That we venerated war above all other human activities? America has ended up with a landscape of denial. James Buchanan's house denies that our 15th president was gay. Fort Pillow denies that Nathan Bedford Forrest's Confederates massacred surrendered U.S. troops there. The National Mining Hall of Fame and Museum denies that mining today causes any environmental damage. And so it goes, from sea to shining sea. These misrepresentations on the American landscape help keep us ignorant as a people, less able to understand what really happened in the past, and less able to apply our understanding to issues facing the United States today. The thoughtful visitor can learn to read between the lines of historical markers, however, and deconstruct the imagery on historic monuments. Then these sites divulge important insights, not only about the eras they describe, but also about the eras in which they were built. In short, the lies and omissions memorialized across the American countryside suggest times and ways that the United States went astray as a nation. They also point to unresolved issues in a third era, our own. That's why it may be more important to understand what the historical landscape gets wrong than what it gets right. So, come along as we visit more than 100 markers, monuments, houses, and other historic sites in all 50 states and the District of Columbia. Our journey will start in the West, mirroring the journey the first people made as they discovered the Americas and settled it from west to east. People got to the Americas by boat from Northeast Asia or by walking across the Bering Strait during an ice age. Most Indians in the Americas can be traced by blood type, language similarity, and other evidence to a very small group of first arrivals. Thus, they may have come by boat. Either way, afoot or by boat, evidence suggests that Native Americans share some cultural and physical similarities with Northern Asians to the west of Alaska. Beginning in the West has the additional benefit of being unconventional. How refreshing it would be, ethnohistorian James Axtell wrote, to find a textbook that began on the West Coast before treating the traditional Eastern colonies. The usual approach to the American past is from the vantage point of Boston, looking southwestward. Travel books, too, start in New England, even though four Asian countries, Japan, China, Korea, and India, send more tourists to the United States than the top four European nations, the United Kingdom, Germany, France, and Italy. Europeans, too, Spaniards, were living in New Mexico years before Anglos had moved to New England or Virginia, so it is doubly appropriate for us to make our trip from west to east. Therefore, we will begin in the state that extends farthest west, Alaska, and end in Maine, farthest east. You don't have to go that direction, however. The Index of States invites you to proceed alphabetically by state, or to begin with whatever state interests you, and cross-references within and at the end of entries encourage you to explore topically related entries. On our journey, not only will we uncover new facts about the American past, but we will also catch indications of hidden fault lines in the social structure of the United States today. Some of these places are familiar to millions of Americans: Boston Common, Valley Forge, the Jefferson Memorial, Abraham Lincoln's Log Cabin, and Sutter's Fort. Other entries in this book will visit places and tell stories that have not been memorialized grandly on the landscape. You will meet people whose existence you may never have imagined. For instance, Elizabeth Van Loo, Robert and Marianne Lumpkin, and Patty Cannon, and perhaps learn some facts you never imagined about famous Americans you thought you knew well. Some of these sites lie far off well-traveled tourist paths and never get into most travel guidebooks. Other markers or statues stand in oft-visited places, but unobtrusively, such as the plaques in the entry halls of state capitals. Although few writers have commented on most of these monuments and markers, they too make a difference, because they represent the thousands of other historic sites all across America that help frame the way we talk about the past, yet have never drawn the attention of the historical profession. These barely known but important sites bring up the critical distinction between what happened in the past versus what we say about it. The former is the past, the latter, history. Ideally, I believe the two should match. Some people do not agree. In 1925, the American Legion declared that American history, at least when taught to children, must inspire the children with patriotism, must be careful to tell the truth optimistically, and must speak chiefly of success. Since the American past is littered with failures as well as successes, and since the past cannot be changed, the Legion would have history lie or say little about the failures. So would a lot of other people. It follows that sites that are important but little known may have been left out of history because their stories would be unsettling to some Americans. Conversely, nothing much happened in actuality at some allegedly important sites, Valley Forge for one, but history has made a great to-do about them. Some monuments and markers tell their stories completely and accurately, so not every entry will be critical of its site. Sites are also depicted favorably, I'm sure, when their bias matches my own. And my biases can be inferred from the list of heroes to whose memory this book is dedicated. I have chosen these sites to correct historical interpretations that seem profoundly wrong to me, and to tell neglected but important stories about the American past. To be honest, I also included a few because they're funny. Americans share a common history that unites us, but we also share some more difficult events, a common history that divides us. These things, too, we must remember, for only then can we understand our divisions and work to reduce them. Markers and monuments could help, except too often they suffer from the same forces that created the divisions in the first place. Moreover, Most historic sites don't just tell stories about the past. They also tell visitors what to think about the stories they tell. Many sites seek to transform our secular history, events that actually happened on Earth, done by real people, with the usual mix of admirable and despicable characteristics, into hallowed milestones along the path of our sacred journey as a nation. But if a monument or marker misrepresents the past or tells it from only one biased viewpoint, then whatever moral imperative it suggests must be suspect. If we cannot face our history honestly, we cannot learn from the past. Americans agree with this proposition when applied to other countries. We commend Germany for preserving concentration camps as monuments of remembrance. We commend the Russians for changing Leningrad back to St. Petersburg, rather than continuing to honor a man whose political philosophy wreaked havoc on so many lives. We understand when South Africans, after dethroning white supremacy, set about reevaluating their statues and museum exhibits honoring white supremacists. Surely the United States, like Germany, Russia, or South Africa, needs to rethink its past and reassess how it commemorates that past in stone. Surely we don't want to be people of the lie, complicit with the worst in American history because we cannot stand to acknowledge it. The way we heal is to come face to face with the truth, and then we can better deal with it and each other. I wrote back in 1999 that this process was already underway. Since then, as the preface to this new edition tells, we have made great strides in making our public history more accurate and more candid. Throughout this book, entries will show how history, as remembered in town squares and on highway waysides, has changed over time. Even though monuments are written in stone, they are not permanent. Americans have forever been talking back to the landscape, whether by persuading a state to revise the wording on a historical marker or by vandalizing a statue. On the whole, it is a healthy process. The history written on the American landscape was written by people, after all, and we, the people, have the power to take back the landscape and make it ours. When a site tells an inaccurate or incomplete story, challenging what our public history commemorates can make a difference in our public discourse. Indeed, questioning the myths as told on the American landscape is intrinsically subversive, since the interrogation itself diminishes their power to motivate human behavior, a power that depends on shared belief. Questioning the myths requires serious historical research. Often the viewpoint of the dominant faction not only rules the landscape, but also permeates the history books. In the last 30 years, however, researchers have unearthed new voices from the past and allowed them to speak in their books and articles. Altering the landscape, then, involves expanding our public history by telling about the past from these new perspectives. In the process, new markers and monuments will establish new stories and extol new heroes, factually based, with feet of clay when appropriate, but role models nonetheless. American history is longer, larger, more various, more beautiful, and more terrible than anything anyone has ever said about it, wrote James Baldwin. The truth is also more wonderful and more terrible than the lies Americans have been telling themselves. The next five essays provide some tools and provisions for our journey. Some Functions of Public History examines the roles that monuments, markers, and other historic sites play for individuals and our society. The Sociology of Historic Sites tells how historical markers get created in the first place and suggests that their local nature has both positive and negative implications for the history they relate. Historic sites are always a tale of two eras, notes that every site can teach visitors not only about the event or person it commemorates, but also something about the time of its erection or preservation. Therefore, visitors must consider both eras when thinking about what the site says. Hieratic scale in historic monuments discusses how the non-verbal symbolism on monuments and memorials influences how visitors think and feel about the topics they commemorate. Public History, after Charlottesville, tells of the ongoing questioning of our white supremacist landscape, inadvertently triggered by two white supremacist events, the murders of 9 parishioners in a historic black church in Charleston, South Carolina, in 2015, and the Unite the Right rally in Charlottesville, Virginia, 2 years later. Aided by these discussions and Appendix B, 10 questions to ask at a historic site, readers will be better able to critique the next place they visit, even if it is not among the more than 100 sites described here. After our tour of lies across America, a final essay will provide some ideas on what to do about the biased texts, inappropriate names, and unfit statues we will have encountered. Getting into a dialogue with the landscape points out that even though history on the landscape looks permanent, revision constantly takes place. It tells how Americans have changed many sites already, and suggests ways that readers can make our markers, monuments, and historic sites tell a fuller, more accurate history. Finally, Appendix C lists 20 candidates that still deserve immediate removal or revision. Some functions of public history. Why have Americans put up hundreds of thousands of markers and monuments across the landscape? Why have we preserved thousands of historic houses, forts, and ships? That the future may learn from the past is the motto of Colonial Williamsburg. Surely that's a good justification, especially since 83% of all Americans, turned off by their high school history textbooks, never take a course in American history beyond high school. Unfortunately, learning from the past is hardly the only reason for public history. It's not even the primary reason, including for Colonial Williamsburg itself, which has evolved into a powerful money-making machine. Popular education in history is a market commodity, says Kerry Carson, Colonial Williamsburg's vice president for research. Boston's Freedom Trail, taking visitors from plaque to building, marker to monument, has become the city's number one tourist attraction. It has been joined by a Women's Heritage Trail, Black Heritage Trail, Literary Trail, and Historical Map of Lesbian and Gay Boston, seeking more niche tourism dollars. It's revealing to examine the various functions, economic, political, social, and cultural, as well as educational, that preserving historic sites and erecting markers and monuments play for individuals and society. First, there is the role that stories play in human culture. Human beings live by stories. Individuals who have not forged a heroic narrative of their own can nonetheless feel part of something important. In this case, our nation's progress, by identifying with others who performed heroic deeds. Remembering these deeds on the landscape meets this human need. Putting up markers and monuments and preserving historic sites also allows affluent Americans to feel good about their wealth and fame, their knowledge and civic-mindedness, and often their ancestors. Usually, behind even the simplest aluminum plaque lurks someone who feels good about its installation. The efforts of the upper class to commemorate their history help them feel better psychologically. The results also help them stay upper. History is power. Those on top of society, including John D. Rockefeller and his social classmates who started Colonial Williamsburg, know this. Therefore, they take the time to determine how history will be remembered. Historic sites also help hold society together, providing a shared community heritage. 10th-generation Americans and recent immigrants alike can glory in what the founders achieved in Philadelphia and feel sorrow for the dead listed on the Vietnam Veterans Memorial. Monuments and markers provide sacred sites for what sociologist Robert Bella called America's civil religion. Memorials, in particular, declare what is worth dying for, which turns out to be mostly the state in war. In turn, most American war memorials transform their conflicts into noble causes, decided by the will of the people. Consequently, public history, as it is called, usually fosters the civic status quo by praising the government and defending its acts. Rarely do historic markers and monuments criticize the state. Chapter 11. Instead, they make things that were problematic seem appropriate, ordained, even commendable. Why did the United States choose to fight in, say, World War I or Vietnam? Why did the Southern states secede? Why do men, and not women, rule? Why did this particular man rule? These are not easy questions. Scholars have written whole books wrestling with them. Most monuments and markers ignore them and proclaim flatly, "Whatever happened was good." Things worth thinking about are converted into things taken for granted. Even a modest plaque on the side of a building helps set a tone that discourages thinking, for it speaks with authority, implying that the community agreed at some point that its message was not only incontestable, but also important enough to be on permanent display. The usual emotion at the dedication of most monuments and markers is celebratory, even smug. But a rosy view of the past can help make injustice in the present seem more acceptable. I have been told that public history doesn't matter. What difference do old monuments in the park really make? Who now even recalls who the county or high school was named after? The fact that Edgefield, South Carolina, dedicated a granite monument to veterans for preserving our freedom and way of life during the Vietnam War does not force residents of the town to agree that that was America's role in that war or our reason for intervening. And correcting a historical marker whose language and inaccurate history disrespect American Indians, for instance, doesn't send a single Native American child to college. Most of us have felt the force of public history, however, written across America in bronze, aluminum, marble, and granite, and in buildings and battlefields preserved for us today. Being at the place where history was made has a certain power. It may have been this chair where Abraham Lincoln sat when he had lunch here, a tourist I did not know whispered as we reached the parlor of the White House of the Confederacy in Richmond, Chapter 61. "That gives me the shivers," he continued. The statue of Juan de Oñate in New Mexico, Chapter 19, enables some Hispanic visitors to identify with a heroic forebear, while it arouses rage in some Native American visitors at the heroification of a bloody conquistador. The Lincoln Memorial in Washington, D.C., prompts visitors to react with pride, regret, elation, sorrow, remorse, happiness, and rededication. The Jefferson Davis Monument in Fairview, Kentucky, Chapter 15, prompts some of the same reactions among neo-Confederate sympathizers. Sometimes, the historical marker becomes more important than the site itself. If the place has changed, plaques offer something to see, a way to connect with the event. For example, my hometown, Decatur, Illinois, was the site of the 1860 statewide convention of the Illinois Republican Party. Here, for the first time, Abraham Lincoln's name was put forth for president. I knew this growing up because in 1915, the Daughters of the American Revolution, DAR, had put a bronze tablet on the side of the bank on the street where a huge tent, the Wigwam, had housed the gathering. That plaque kept the memory of the event alive. In 1970, the DAR put up another plaque with a bas-relief of the tent. Then in 2010, to mark its sesquicentennial, a Decatur artist created four bronze silhouettes illustrating the event. Since Lincoln entered the convention after the tent was jammed by 2,500 people, he got to the front by being hoisted up and passed hand to hand over the heads of the crowd. So the silhouettes are dramatic and amusing. They keep alive the memory of the event, even though parked cars now occupy most of the street. Even when the countryside hasn't changed much, as is the case for the monuments commemorating the Mountain Meadows Massacre in southern Utah, in itself the landscape reveals little of what happened at the site more than a century earlier. The story is told on the marker, or monument, or it should be. Historic sites even take on a celebrity of their own. Stone Mountain in Georgia is an obvious example, visited by tourists who have no interest in the Civil War, much less any leading toward the Confederacy. They simply want to see what is reputed to be the world's largest monument, Chapter 53. Even lowly historical markers can put a town on the map, I know of two different small towns whose residents hijacked and hid their only marker when they learned that the state had threatened to remove it because it was inaccurate. The economic function of public history can provide a mechanism for civic improvement. For at least 20 years, the state of Alabama has been aware that black visitors spend green money, just as white visitors do. Its one-page handout to entice visitors is headed, "Alabama, fun and games begin here," with five woodcuts below. The first is of Martin Luther King Jr., followed by a golfer. The juxtaposition of title and pictures is truly jarring. There is no way to fit the Birmingham church where the KKK bombed four girls at Sunday school, King's own church in Montgomery, or now the new museum about the Scottsboro Boys under the heading Fun and Games. The order of the images, with King first, however, implies that the state believes that more visitors will come to see civil rights sites than to golf, visit historic homes, see Civil War battlefields, or learn about Alabama's role in the space program. Readers who want to create more accurate public history can use this awareness that it can be good for the bottom line in a community, not just for its residents' knowledge and humanity. What a community erects on its historical landscape not only sums up its view of the past, but also influences its possible futures. Returning to our Vietnam example, it is hard for residents of Edgefield to honor Americans who fought against the Vietnam War so long as their downtown monument credits those who fought in the war for being right. It will always seem right for whites to command our governments, law firms, and corporations so long as whites are on top of our statues, helping and dominating African Americans and Native Americans on the bottom. It is hard for Southern whites today to emulate or even learn about white Southerners who enlisted in the Union armies or fought for black rights during Reconstruction, so long as every Southern courthouse town boasts a monument conflating the Confederate cause with Deo Vindice, God our Vindicator, and states' rights. It is harder for women to win election as president, so long as many Americans believe that women have done little up to now, partly because monuments and markers omit their actions. What one generation puts on the landscape thus becomes a force imprisoning the minds of the generations that follow. On the other hand, recognizing local history on the landscape helps empower people to make more local history. And as Congressman Tip O'Neill said about politics, ultimately, all history is local. It happened here. The first woman to win office in the community, the racial desegregation of the school, the town's response to a natural disaster, the most important people and ideas that have come from the area, all these are worthy of note, and noting them may make it more likely that townspeople will continue to do things worthy of note. In every locale, markers and monuments can define what that community has done and can symbolize its citizens' aspirations. Our challenge is to create a public history that functions for us as we go about our business as Americans, which is to bring into being the America of the future. The sociology of historic sites. Desperate to cause change in their city and nation, student demonstrators in Beijing in 1989 recognized the power of monuments to move people. Students erected a styrofoam and plaster statue, Goddess of Liberty, opposite Mao's portrait in Tiananmen Square to symbolize their aspirations and legitimize their acts. The Chinese government likewise recognized the symbolic power of the goddess. "This statue is illegal," blared government loudspeakers. "It is not approved by the government. Even in the United States, statues need permission before they can be put up." Indeed, they do. Americans are not as free as Chinese students may have hoped we are, or as we ourselves might like to think. Statues, historical markers, and monuments do need approval before they can be put up on public property, and only certain kinds have gone up. reviewing the process by which markers and monuments get erected and historic sites get preserved may help explain why so many tell bad history. We begin with historical markers. Historians usually credit, or blame, Virginia for starting statewide highway marker programs in 1927, although New York started the same year. Colorado, Indiana, and Pennsylvania may have put up markers earlier, and Massachusetts had 234 markers in place by 1930. Of course, towns, local organizations, the Daughters of the American Revolution, DAR, and individuals were putting up plaques long before any states got involved. Early state markers were usually the creation of the state marker office, which typically boasted a staff of one person who may or may not have earned a graduate degree in history. As a result, some early markers use offensive terminology and commemorate events that never happened. In the late 1950s and early 1960s, many states hired staff members with backgrounds in history or set up review boards for marker texts, or both. Consequently, in these states, Colorado, Georgia, Kansas, Mississippi, Texas, Virginia, and West Virginia, for example, recent markers are more accurate and more inclusive. Texas has been making a particular effort to ensure that women get included at sites where they played a role. Pennsylvania got a private foundation grant in 1990 for 66 new markers treating African American history in Philadelphia. The final essay in this book, Getting into a Dialogue with the Landscape, tells of wording changes underway in Virginia and other states. In the 1980s and 1990s, some states closed down their marker programs altogether. General governmental retrenchment was responsible, along with the realization that interstate highways, where stopping between exits is prohibited, now draw the bulk of travelers, especially from out of state. Some other states went to a pay-as-you-go basis. Organizations can erect an official state marker only if they pay for it themselves. Usually, the content of such markers is negotiated between the local group and the state marker office. Different states have different rules, but most require some passage of time before a marker can go up. Georgia, for example, requires an event to have taken place generally at least 50 years ago, or, if the proposed marker is about a person, that they be dead at least generally 50 years. Some states require as little as 20 or 30 years, and most allow for exceptions for especially important events or people, as Georgia does by saying generally. Most states have some criteria about the importance of the event or person to be honored. Georgia sets up four options. A. A military operation including conflicts with Native Americans. B. A meeting of persons, the results of which were of lasting historical importance. C. An artistic creation or mechanical device which has been of lasting value to society. Or D. An act of such historic importance as to have changed the course of history of the state or nation. The applicant is to meet this burden of proof with documentation in the form of proper footnotes and a bibliography, preferably including references to primary sources. Proposed texts are vetted by the State Historical Marker Review Committee, which consists of members of the Georgia National Register Review Board. Review boards usually include people from different parts of the state and different racial and ethnic groups. Some may have educational or occupational backgrounds in history. Under Billy Townsend, who directed the Georgia program from 1970 to 2001, Georgia put up a lot of women's historic markers and black historic markers, because basically, for the first 30 years, it was white men, in Townsend's words. Nevertheless, his office and review board didn't have the final say. If a legislator called with a complaint about a marker, he admitted, "We'd take it down." Unlike Townsend, most marker officers take no initiative. For instance, in the words of John Austin, executive director of the Illinois State Historical Society in 1999, "We are reactive, not proactive." It shows. Illinois still has only a handful of markers about individual women, for example, and none for such organizations as the General Federation of Women's Clubs, founded in Chicago in 1890, which had 1 million members by 1910, the Woman's Christian Temperance Union, historically an extremely important organization, whose headquarters are in Evanston, or the League of Women Voters, founded in a Chicago hotel in 1920. Michigan boasts 3 accurate markers about the 1936 General Motors sit-down strike, a good summary of the life of Malcolm X in front of his boyhood home in Lansing, and credible markers on Native Americans. But its historical marker for Orville Hubbard, the notorious racist mayor of Dearborn, never mentions Hubbard's lifelong segregationist policies, Chapter 34. Robin Peebles, who ran Michigan's marker program when the marker went up in the mid-1980s, wanted Hubbard's marker to say he was a segregationist, but was told, "We can't say that. Let's just say everything that we can say." The result is a marker commending Hubbard as an effective administrator. Markers and monuments are often written in stone, but they are not written by gods. People put them up. Although good texts do go up, the process has also gone awry on occasion in every state. When you see a roadside marker, take in what it tells, but also ask, how might this be wrong? One giveaway is the use of qualifying phrases introducing statements of fact, as in, according to tradition, or according to the legislature. Visitors can count on the rest of such sentences to be unsubstantiated. Monuments are even less likely than state historical markers to tell or symbolize impartial history, partly because no relatively disinterested statewide commission reviews what they say or portray. It is harder to summarize the process that creates monuments because, unlike historical markers, each monument is different. But some general statements can be made. Much effort, personal, political, and physical, is required to put up a monument or preserve a house. Little plaques on their backs often disclose the monument's sponsors. But monuments credited to private individuals or organizations also involve some public decision-making, and usually some public monies. Often a private club raises part of a monument's cost and persuades a municipality, county, or state to pay the rest. Even when all the expense is borne privately, a public entity usually contributes to the site and maintains the monument thereafter. Conversely, even publicly funded monuments are often forced into being by pressure from private organizations. Visitors need to understand why those who put up the monument went to such trouble, choosing the location, getting governmental approval, mobilizing support, paying for, designing, building, and finally erecting it. Appendix B supplies 10 questions visitors can ask wherever history is told to them. To ask these questions is to explore the sociological importance and ideological purpose of the monument, marker, or site. My 1995 book, Lies My Teacher Told Me, examined how Americans present the past in high school history textbooks. Textbooks have no plaques on their backs revealing their sponsorship, but they too are written by people, not gods, despite their all-knowing monotone. Textbooks also pass through a process, not unlike that for markers and monuments. Sales representatives lobby municipal, county, or state governmental bodies to get them adopted. Unlike markers and monuments, however, textbooks are developed as national products intended for the entire United States. Most historic markers and monuments are products of local discussions. This makes for several differences. For example, I faulted textbooks for downplaying Indian wars, especially those in the East. Perhaps the most violent Indian war was King Philip's War, which ravaged New England in 1675 to 76. While many U.S. history textbooks leave it out entirely, 11% of the 234 markers that Massachusetts put up in 1930 for its 300th anniversary dealt with King Philip's War. Another 10% treated other Indian wars. By contrast, only 2.6% mentioned the Revolutionary War. That's because King Philip's War cost more American lives in combat in Massachusetts than the Revolution did throughout the entire United States. King Philip's War touched virtually every Massachusetts town. The Revolutionary War did not. Conflict with Native Americans, similarly, gets much attention in West Virginia, 20.1% of 750 historical markers, Georgia, Ohio, North Dakota, and many other states. Indeed, the American landscape is filled with reminders of Indian wars that have almost vanished from our written history. Some of these markers exemplify what historian Francis Jennings calls the cant of conquest, chapters 7, 35, and 66. But no one reading them can fail to understand that Native Americans lived all across America and contested the seizure of their land and homes. The landscape is also superior to American history textbooks in its portrayal of conflicts between workers and owners. I had expected to find that America's rather bloody history of strikes and strike breaking would be invisible on the American landscape, but I had overlooked the power of labor unions. Chapter 9 tells how labor unions have marked the sites of many bloody confrontations with management and police forces across the United States. It also tells of the markers and monuments documenting some of the disasters that have killed scores of workers in factories and mines across America. On reflection, these representations of workers and labor issues should not have surprised me. Labor unions have precisely the three factors needed to influence state marker offices: political influence, some historical expertise, and money for the marker. If labor sometimes wins representation in stone, the upper class always does. According to Susan Schreiber of the National Trust for Historic Preservation, all of the first 19 sites the trust acquired were originally owned by the elite, except the Usonian House, which architect Frank Lloyd Wright created for the average American. And the Usonian House is displayed on the grounds of Woodlawn, a plantation mansion in Virginia. All across America, every town of any substance has its historic house museum, usually in a mansion. In some places, log cabins have been saved and even invented, but the upper class gets represented everywhere. Although the localness of most historic sites can be a force for factual history, more often the resulting provincialism prompts fallacious history. The problem is, communities usually recognize only their happy history on the landscape, the impressive people, the events that most residents can take pride in. Vermont has stated the goals of its historical marker program: provide the traveling public with an awareness of the contributions of Vermont in history and prehistory, foster a sense of the past and pride among Vermonters, educate the public to an understanding of the factors influencing Vermont's development and the contributions Vermont has made to the development of the United States, provide visitors who are entering the state with a sense of its past, encourage positive attitudes toward historic resources. Fostering pride among Vermonters may foster other attitudes my thesaurus likens to pride: arrogance, conceit, condescension, disdain, haughtiness, hubris, and immodesty. These byproducts might reasonably result from presenting a state's past as a story of progress and goodness, something simply to be proud of. Following this policy, one historical marker on Colchester Avenue in Burlington states, "The mortal remains of Ethan Allen, fighter, writer, statesman, and philosopher, lie in this cemetery beneath the marble statue. His spirit is in Vermont now." This is hardly a Native American perspective. Abenakis see Allen as a rapacious Indian hater who manufactured pretexts to steal Indian land. Thus, a tale that arouses pride, with all its synonyms, in one Vermonter may offend and alienate another. Yale professor Robin Winks has criticized historical markers across America as inert, pointless exercises in the most obscure forms of ancestor worship. This Vermont marker is a good example. Its worship of Allen derails any attempt to convey concrete information about the man, so the visitor leaves with no idea of what he did in Vermont, or even when he lived. Our tour of historic sites will lead to many places affected by such local boosterism. Two different towns in Rhode Island claim the site of Massasoit's spring, named for the great Friend of the White Man, when the Pilgrims landed in Massachusetts, Chapter 90. Kentucky and Missouri both claim Daniel Boone's bones. Sometimes these local history wars can get quite local, such as markers just 8 miles apart in New Hampshire, each claiming to be the site of the first public library in the United States, Chapter 87. The sociology of knowledge studies what and how people think. By knowledge, sociologists mean not only fact, but also error, lies as well as truth, and also art, poetry, religion, law, and other intellectual products that can hardly be labeled true or false. One approach the sociology of knowledge takes is to examine the institutional framework within which knowledge is produced. This chapter has begun to analyze the organizational and social contexts that influence what our markers, monuments, and historic places say about the past. The next chapter will look at the art, size, and location of historical monuments, which relate to the influence they wield. Understanding these issues can help visitors avoid being taken in by the lies our public history tries to tell. So can Appendix B. 10 questions to ask at a historic site. Hieratic scale in historic monuments. Monuments convey both less and more than historical markers. They tell less history because they usually have fewer words. In addition, their words are usually chosen to inspire rather than inform. Thus, monuments are more likely to instruct visitors on how to think and feel about the topic they commemorate. The word monument comes from the Latin monere, to remind, admonish, instruct. One way they do this is through their art. Since memory is an intensely visual medium, the images monuments show us often linger in memory long after we have forgotten the words they tell us. Everything you see in a monument has been put there for a reason. Its size, the materials from which it was made, and its position relative to the viewer and to nearby buildings and surrounding elements result from a complex decision-making process that usually involves an artist, the committee that hired the artist, leaders of a sponsoring organization, public officials, and whoever is paying for it all. While pragmatic concerns like money and feasibility do enter into these decisions, the effort is calculated to make an impression upon the visitor. Understanding this allows one to view monuments more analytically. One can still be deeply moved by them, as I am by several monuments in this book, while identifying how they make their impact. Monuments, and many markers, are intended to elicit more than an abstract interest in the past. To begin, most monuments say, "I am important." Some communicate this by being large, even huge. Imagine the shout of "Timber!" That would be fitting for the toppling of the Washington Monument. Even small memorials are usually built for the ages, made of granite, marble, bronze, and the like. These materials assert this mattered and should be honored, because they imply that generations far into the future will still want to know about the persons or events they depict. The grandeur of monuments intrinsically includes an element of consecration, which not only sanctifies the past, but also sanctions future actions. Their very existence implies that the person or event portrayed is worth emulating, or the cause symbolized is worth advancing. They embody a moral imperative: go thou and do likewise. Their landscaping also implies that the people and events remembered on monuments were important and should be honored. In The Theory of the Leisure Class, Thorstein Veblen suggests that the rich prove their affluence, and hence their worth, partly by commanding others to do useless work for them. Useless work is key, Veblen points out. After all, a middle-income farmer can pay a full-time worker to help grow crops on his 240 acres without demonstrating high status. That's just how the farmer makes his living. But a financier who pays a full-time gardener to mow and weed the 10 acres around his mansion in a wealthy suburb makes no money off his land. On the contrary, keeping it nice proves he knows the aesthetic meaning of nice and has the money to achieve it. The extensive lawns and plantings around historic monuments represent similar expenditure on behalf of the persons commemorated, money spent to declare and ensure their status. When trash around a statue is not picked up and its landscaping goes to weed, the person it commemorates probably no longer commands our historical imagination. In Chicago's Grant Park stands a splendid statue of John Logan, carved in 1897 by Augustus St. Gaudens. Logan was an important citizen general during the Civil War, who then helped found the Grand Army of the Republic. When I visited it in 1999, only a few ducks paid any attention to him. One plaque had been ripped off, probably for its scrap value, and derelicts slept at the monument in broad daylight. Logan helped establish Memorial Day to remember Civil War veterans, but his own monument lay forgotten. Many towns built massive monuments to the soldiers and sailors who fought in World War I. But that war to end wars didn't, as Americans found out in 1941. The result is visible across America in the neglect of many World War I memorials. After World War II ended, most communities were not about to rush out to commemorate it because their experience with World War I memorials had soured them on the enterprise. Moreover, the Cold War began immediately, so no one could be sure that the fruits of victory included peace. Monuments built for World War II are comparatively modest. Some merely add plaques to World War I monuments, even though World War II lasted more than twice as long and took more than twice as many American lives as World War I. Size conveys importance. Monuments also communicate eminence by how they portray a person. Thus, the statue of George Washington in the National Museum of American History has the body of a Greek god, even though he didn't. Similarly, Jefferson Davis sits on a horse at Stone Mountain, Georgia, alongside his generals Robert E. Lee and Stonewall Jackson, even though as president of the Confederacy, he spent most of his time behind a desk. We look up to men on horseback, physically and figuratively. Ever since the invention of the automobile, sculptors have scrambled to figure out ways to get passers-by to look up to the people they are characterizing. All across America, monuments depict whites in dominant positions over Native Americans. In front of Isleta Mission in El Paso, Texas, is a monument put up by the Knights of Columbus that features an obsequious Native American kneeling at the feet of a conquistador. On the grounds of the Illinois state capitol stands Father Menard, again with an Indian subservient to him. Further east, in Plattsburgh, New York, Samuel de Champlain stands on a pedestal, towering above a kneeling native. This monument exemplifies European cultural imperialism in two additional ways. First, the sculptor did not bother to depict an Abenaki, or Mohawk, Indians who lived and live yet on the shores of Lake Champlain. Instead, he sculpted a Plains Indian, complete with full feathered headdress. A 10-minute walk through the woods near the lake would have disabused him of the appropriateness of such an item. Also, Champlain is fully clothed, with a cloak and cape, while the Indian is almost naked. Depending on the weather on that spring day in 1609, when Native Americans showed Champlain the lake he discovered, either the Indian was freezing or Champlain was perspiring. Of course, the two aren't supposed to be realistic. The clothing is simply part of the language of power. So is naming the lake for the leader of the first whites to visit it. Chapter 7 suggests problems with discover. All these artistic conventions are called hieratic scale in sculpture, higher as in hierarchy, and date back to depictions of Pharaoh and Christ. African Americans also look up to European Americans on monuments all across the country. In Washington, D.C., in Lincoln Park, east of the Capitol, stands the first statue of Abraham Lincoln put up after his death. It reads, Freedom's Memorial. In grateful memory of Abraham Lincoln, this monument was erected by the Western Sanitary Commission of St. Louis, Missouri, with funds contributed solely by emancipated citizens of the U.S., declared free by his proclamation, January 1, A.D., 1863. Crouched at Lincoln's feet, his chains still on but broken, is a semi-naked African-American. The monument shows the respect African-Americans felt for Lincoln and also plays the important role of representing Lincoln's role as great emancipator and his concern, often inconsistent, to be sure, for black civil rights. In the words of William G. Eliot, a friend of the escaped slave who was the sculptor's model, the slave in the monument has grasped the chain, as if in the act of breaking it, indicating the historical fact that the slaves took an active part in their own deliverance. Inadvertently, however, the sculpture also shows the power of the cultural archetype over non-white, as well as white minds, because it follows the conventions of hieratic scale. At Tuskegee Institute in Alabama, a similar statue varies the theme. Booker T. Washington stands, removing the cloak of ignorance from the young African-American man who kneels before him. Aware of Washington's accommodationist stance, vis-à-vis the white power structure around 1900, Tuskegee undergraduates joke about whether he is taking off or putting back the cloak. The huge Indiana State Soldiers and Sailors Monument dominates the Circle in downtown Indianapolis. The Civil War monument includes many figures, men fight in battle, reunited sweethearts kiss, etc. All are white, except the lowest figure on the sculpture. He is a former slave, again semi-reclining. He holds up his arm with dangling broken chains, apparently in thankful supplication to the fair woman, presumably Columbia, symbolizing the nation, who has smashed his shackles for him. No African-American could possibly take pride in this representation. He lies passive, conveying no hint that nearly 200,000 African-Americans, including some from Indiana, fought in the Army and Navy of the United States during the Civil War. Thus, although it celebrates the end of slavery and does allow an African-American a bit part, the monument still conveys white supremacy. Whites built it in 1889, well after the end of Reconstruction, when the United States was pushing African Americans back into second-class citizenship. 35 years later, the Ku Klux Klan dominated the state. The Klan would parade around and around the monument because its white supremacy was mirrored symbolically on the tableau. Gender is an important element of social relations, and patriarchy is an important element of hierarchy in America. Does it show in the landscape? Some monuments do show women in inferior positions. The most common example is the generic plaque on many Spanish-American War monuments, Chapter 25. It shows a native woman kneeling, like the ex-slave, with her chains broken, facing the white Americans who seem to have smashed them. More often, women are at the top of monuments, but these women are neither specific individuals, nor do they symbolize women generically. Instead, they usually represent the state, liberty, or angels of peace, comfort, or death. The woman of the Spanish-American War monuments kneels not because of her gender, but because she is native. So far as I know, all but one of the women on top are white. The exception crowns the dome of the U.S. Capitol. She is a bronze woman called the Statue of Freedom. Many tourists take her to be an American Indian because she wears a buffalo robe, and her helmet is topped by an eagle's head and flowing plumage. Also, the colonies, and later the new nation, often used an Indian to represent liberty. Ironically, her headdress is neither American Indian, nor does it represent liberty. Jefferson Davis, Secretary of War during the Pierce administration, objected to the original design, a Liberty cap worn by French revolutionaries. He worried that this was a Yankee protest against slavery, or might give slaves ideas of freedom. He ordered a feathered helmet encircled by stars instead. The Statue of Freedom figure has always been Roman. But if most Americans think she is an Indian, then for practical purposes, she has become a Native American. Generic images of women do get on the landscape. The Daughters of the American Revolution put up Madonna of the Trail statues all across America, from Pomona, California to Bethesda, Maryland in 1928, commemorating women pioneers. Other examples abound, such as the Pilgrim Mother in Plymouth, Massachusetts. Gender bias becomes clearer when we move from generic figures to individual women. Representations of real women from history are much less common than those of men, partly because so many monuments across the United States memorialize war. Even in peacetime, however, important specific women are not recognized on the landscape in many states, while less important men are. Chapters 30 and 41. Hieratic scale shows in other ways as well. At Manassas Battlefield in Virginia, Stonewall Jackson rides a horse that has muscles on its muscles. No horse ever looked like this, and Jackson's surely did not. Again, we are to be in awe of the horse's power, and by extension, of Jackson. Chapter 32 tells how even mares must be male, and Chapter 19 tells how even a lithe Spanish horse ends up a Budweiser Clydesdale. As women, workers, people of color, and others whose stories have not been told on the American landscape gain recognition, a question arises. Will they get the same type of embodiments as white men of high status, or will more humane conceptions replace the canons of hieratic scale? It is too early to tell. But there is something paradoxical about Martin Luther King Jr. towering over us as he emerges from a boulder. He who helped lead a movement of ordinary people and risked jail to gain equal rights for all. Two recent monuments to famous women give hope that new conventions may replace hieratic scale. In Chicago, a series of interlinked hands represents Jane Addams, while the Eleanor Roosevelt statue in New York makes her life-sized and approachable. Perhaps bronze and marble will give way to new materials: holography, sound, mobile phone messages, websites. Perhaps Americans can put up enough new monuments honoring hitherto neglected people and events in enough new forms that we will relegate hieratic scale to a period in our past, like Art Deco. At that point, monuments will no longer have to be, well, monumental to succeed in touching their visitors and revealing important aspects of our past. The next chapter treats the chronological contexts of markers and monuments because when history was written or symbolized helps explain how. Historic sites are always a tale of two eras. Whether monumental in scale or just a small plaque affixed to a building, every historic site tells two different stories about two different eras in the past. One is its manifest narrative, the event or person heralded in its text or artwork. The other is the story of its erection or preservation. The images on our monuments and the language on our markers reflect the attitudes and ideas of the time when Americans put them up, often many years after the event. Americans have typically adjusted the visible past on the landscape to make what we remember conform to the needs of the current time. To understand a marker or monument, we must not only analyze what it says and how it looks, but also when it was unveiled. To understand a historic site, we need to know when its interpretation, what the guides show and tell, was established. Why was this story told then? What audience was it aimed at? How would the story differ if we were telling it today, or in another 50 years? Too often, our historic sites relate inaccurate and misleading history owing to the ideological demands of the time and the purpose of their erection or preservation. One way to ferret out bias is to see what historians writing in other eras said about the event. What would people have thought if this had been put up when the person still lived, or the event had just happened? Another approach is to return to primary sources, making sure to include sources from all acting groups. Learning about when the marker or monument went up takes us out of the present to reveal why people then chose that person or event to commemorate. Pondering what people will say 50 years hence about this site takes us out of the present in the opposite direction and can help disclose limitations in our vision today. When examined thoughtfully with these cautions in mind, historic sites always reveal something, accurate or inaccurate, about the period they describe and the period when they went up or were preserved, and perhaps about our own time as well. The foregoing paragraphs form an introduction to the concept of historiography, perhaps the most important tool that historians offer the world. Unfortunately, very few Americans, even teachers of history and social studies in K through 12 schools, know the concept, so they cannot teach it to others. Historiography most simply means the study of history, but not in the sense of, oh gosh, I'm behind, I've got to do historiography this weekend. Historiography means the study of the writing of history. It asks us to look at a piece, an article, textbook, historical marker, even a photograph, and ask, who wrote this, or built it, or painted it, etc.? Who did not? Whose perspective is omitted? What was the author's purpose? And so on. All this relates to the question of historical perspective. The passage of time, some people assume, somehow provides perspective. State historical marker programs implicitly make this assumption when they require that 30 or 50 years elapse after an event before a marker can commemorate it. Unfortunately, it is more common to invoke historic perspective than to think cogently about it. I have found useful a distinction that some societies in East and Central Africa make. According to religious scholar John Mbiti, Kiswahili speakers divide the deceased into two categories, Sasha and Zamani. The recently departed, whose time on earth overlapped with people still here, are the Sasha, living dead. They are not wholly dead, for they live on in the memories of the living, who can call them to mind, create their likeness in art, and bring them to life in anecdote. When the last person to know an ancestor dies, that ancestor leaves the Sasha for the Zamani, the dead. As generalized ancestors, the Zamani are not forgotten but revered. Many, like our George Washington or Clara Barton, can be recalled by name. But they are not living dead. There is a difference. By extension, a person's Sasha is that period when they were aware of societal happenings. For me, born in 1942, my Sasha would be from about 1952 to the present. Before 1952, history is Zamani for me. Historical perspective does not always accrue from the passage from Sasha to Zamani. On the contrary, more accurate history, certainly more detailed history, can often be written while an event lies in the Sasha. For then, people on all sides still have first-hand knowledge of the event. Primary source material, on which historians rely, comes from the Sasha. To assume that historians or sociologists can make better sense of it later in the Zamani is merely chronological ethnocentrism. Monuments lend little support to the idea of historical perspective. Many monuments and most tombstones are products of the Sasha. Family members often erect memorials to their beloved dead within weeks of their passing from the living into the Sasha. In a sense, this is the most local history of all, and sometimes the most accurate. Sasha monuments are often located in cemeteries or quiet parks. Sasha monuments and markers often simply remember an event and those who died in it, often listing them, and sometimes the living, by name. Zamani monuments are usually quite different. Not primarily motivated by loss or grief, Zamani monuments and markers usually go up to serve the political exigencies of the time of their erection. They make the ideological point their erectors need to make to respond to those exigencies. They seek to influence how people behave by telling them what to think about the ancestor, event, or cause they commemorate. Often, Zamani monuments get put up downtown, where their presence on important public land at the courthouse or city hall implies that the community is united in the sentiments they express. People who do not share their sentiments and would not seek them out in cemeteries or parks will see them and presumably be influenced by them in these locations. One reason to delay putting up markers and monuments is to avoid controversies about people and events still in the Sasha. But the end of a controversy may not signal agreement on a disinterested consensus account. In Political Influence, Edward C. Banfield analyzed local governments as arenas of competing interest groups. Often, no one group can get its way, so long as other groups are strong enough to create a controversy. Thus, various groups have informal veto power. Decades after an event, however, some groups may have lapsed into inactivity, lost social power, died out, or moved on to other issues, leaving one individual or group to decide how an event is remembered. When only one segment of society, usually the white elite, controls public memory, distorted history is the result. During the nadir of race relations from 1890 until about 1940, white supremacists had the power to determine how the Civil War and Reconstruction would be remembered in the South. Having disfranchised African Americans outright and terrorized white Republicans into submission. After 1890, in an important sense, the South, or rather the white neo-Confederate South, won the Civil War. They won it because they won what secession was all about, white supremacy. Of course, the South had seceded specifically to maintain and extend slavery, but slavery was in the service of white supremacy. Some of the reasons Southern leaders gave for seceding had only to do with the latter. Mississippi, for example, said it was seceding partly because it, the Republican Party, advocates Negro equality socially and politically. In 1890, Mississippi ended racial equality with its new, openly racist state constitution. People always put up monuments after they win. The new Confederate monuments also showed white supremacy by their placement next to the instruments of power, courthouses and state capitals. Unfortunately, this was also the great period of monument building in the United States and Europe, which also helps explain why so many Confederate and neo-Confederate statues went up then. These new monuments, put up by neo-Confederate organizations, like the United Daughters of the Confederacy and Sons of Confederate Veterans, distorted why the South seceded, Chapter 74, and made hash of Civil War history from beginning, Chapter 60, to end, Chapter 65. To these groups, erecting monuments was a way to continue the Civil War by other means. As a result, to this day, those who worked for civil rights in the 19th century, including ex-Confederate General James Longstreet, Chapter 44, get far less recognition on the landscape than people who worked against civil rights, such as ex-Confederate Albert Pike. Thus, objective historical perspective does not necessarily result from the passage of time. Instead, visitors must always ask what points of view dominated the period when the marker or monument went up or the site was preserved. The success of the civil rights movement of the 1960s, not just the passage of a few more decades, prompted revisions in our public landscape of white supremacy. Not only did Martin Luther King Jr., but also Frederick Douglass, Barbara Jordan, and other champions of equal rights for African Americans now have streets and schools named for them. General Longstreet, too, has recently gotten more and kinder treatment on the landscape, including a statue at Gettysburg. In 1948, Minnesota misremembered the Philippine-American War with a beautiful large bronze plaque in its state capitol, containing phrases that some returning veterans from that war would have protested bitterly in 1899. Chapter 25. The United States was sending aid and military advisors all over the globe to help other nations stop communism in 1948, allegedly for their own good. Picturing American involvement in the Philippine-American War as a similar example of global civic-mindedness made sense in those Cold War years, but it does not in our time, and it did not in 1899. The previous sentence invokes a third age that comes into play whenever one visits a historic site, the viewer's own era. Is it fair-minded of us to see these sites through the lens of the present? Some people argue that when we criticize historic monuments and markers, we are being anachronistic, judging people of the past by the standards of our time. Typically, however, when the proponents of change dig deeply, they find that those celebrated people and events from past eras, whose acts contravene standards of justice and conduct in our time, turn out to have been controversial figures in their own time as well. When Americans choose to leave in place a monument or leave a street named for a controversial person, we continue to honor their actions in our time. We imply to future generations that by today's standards, we judge this person to be worthy of remembrance and emulation. When Americans let biased monuments stand with no plaques to balance or contextualize their stories, and when we fail to revise inaccurate or incomplete historical markers, we imply that we continue to endorse these accounts, even though we now know a fuller story. If we don't mean to do this, we need to revise the landscape in our time. Sometimes, change is easy. King County, encompassing Seattle, Washington, was named for William Rufus King, vice president under President Franklin Pierce. The next county to the south was named for Pierce. Washington became a territory during the Pierce administration. King had been a senator from Alabama and, like Pierce, was a member of the extreme pro-slavery wing of the Democratic Party. In 1986, officials renamed King County King County for civil rights leader Martin Luther King, Jr. Not even a sheet of letterhead had to be discarded. But even that change wasn't easy. The vote was 6-5. Sometimes change is hard because reasonable people can differ about the historic merit and meaning of persons or events of the past. The 1995 controversy over naming a building at Iowa State University for an Iowa suffragist offers such a case. Carrie Chapman Catt was a national leader in the women's movement in the early decades of the 20th century. Like some other feminists in those years, but not all, she said that women should be allowed to vote because white supremacy will be strengthened, not weakened, by woman suffrage. She went on to argue that the United States should cut off the vote of the slums and give it to woman. She was also outraged that the United States would let brutal, treacherous, murderous Indians vote and not white women. Proponents of renaming Old Botany Hall Carrie Chapman Catt Hall argued that Catt was a product of her times and should be judged by the standards of those times, not our time. The question is not whether she's a woman of our time, wrote Iowa State English professor Deborah Marquardt, criticizing the renaming, but rather whether she's a woman for our time. When we put her name on a building and dedicate the building to her memory, she becomes a kind of artifact we have chosen and a symbol we pass on to future generations. Surely Marquardt was right about the principle. A case for Catt can nonetheless be made. Donna Lively, a self-identified woman of color, writing her Ph.D. dissertation on Catt, said, "I am disturbed, however, that Carrie Chapman Catt is being remembered only in terms of her racism. This is an extremely monolithic view of her life. On some occasions, after women won the right to vote, Catt did speak out against racism in the United States, and when the Nazis began persecuting Jews in Europe, she organized a protest by non-Jewish women. The hall remains Carrie Chapman Catt Hall, and arguments over the name continue at Iowa State." When proponents of change do their homework and show that a person or event was controversial in the past, and has been idealized in the teeth of damning evidence ever since, their opponents cannot reasonably claim that correcting markers or removing monuments does violence to our history. Instead, they usually argue that the proposed revision does violence to our heritage. The heritage syndrome, as historian Michael Kamen calls it, is an impulse to remember what is attractive or flattering, and is to ignore all the rest. Thus, history and heritage are not the same. Indeed, the two are often at odds. When Edward Ball, in the 1990s, began to research his family's ownership of slaves, some older members of his family grew upset. While they reveled in the heritage of their links to the gentry of the antebellum South, they did not want Ball bringing out what actually happened, the family history, which Ball nevertheless presented in his interesting book, Slaves in the Family. The conflict between history and heritage goes still deeper. Too often, events that reek of dishonor and shame get abracadabra'd into a noble heritage. In the early 1990s, Governor Jim Folsom ordered Alabama to stop flying the Confederate battle flag from the state capitol. Immediately, neo-Confederates condemned him for what they called a heritage violation. Folsom had no problem with the Confederate flag flying from the first White House of the Confederacy across the street, where its presence was historically appropriate, but the state capitol had flown the flag only since the day in April 1963, when Attorney General Robert F. Kennedy visited the building to meet with Governor George Wallace about desegregating the University of Alabama. Then, Wallace had used it as a symbol of resistance and white supremacy. So the flag on the capitol did not really symbolize anything about the Civil War, but rather a tawdry attempt to maintain white supremacy during the civil rights era. The point to neo-Confederates is not to put the Confederacy into its proper historical context, but to maintain its symbols as sites for homage in the present. Thus, neo-Confederates charge heritage violation every time people in a community want to remove a monument to white supremacy, Chapter 44. Or stop naming a high school after KKK leader Nathan Bedford Forrest, Chapter 52. History gains by these kinds of changes. Now that the community no longer must defend its decision to honor such a person or cause, it can afford to tell more about them. Also, the public can develop a more sophisticated understanding of the nature of history from the change on the landscape, especially if a plaque leaves a record of the prior monument or name. The heritage lost is the tradition of decades of distorting an event or honoring a repulsive person. Losing this legacy is precisely the point. The next essay tells how two criminal acts by neo-Confederates, coupled with ideological opposition to white supremacy, led to a new era of public history in the second decade of the 21st century. Public history after Charlottesville. At least since the 1960s, our public history has been contested. Even before the first edition of this book came out in 1999, people were shooting historical markers full of holes in West Virginia, using dynamite to topple a monument in Chicago, sawing a foot off a statue in New Mexico, Chapter 19, and changing offensive place names all over the country. A few apologies were even beginning to appear on the landscape. In Lies My Teacher Told Me, I wrote that some racial atrocities, such as the 1921 riot in Tulsa, Oklahoma, in which whites even dropped dynamite from an airplane onto a black ghetto, killing more than 75 people and destroying more than 1,100 homes, have completely vanished from our history books. I visited Tulsa in 1996, expecting to find no hint of this horrendous event, only to discover an impressive new memorial put up by blacks and whites together, about to be dedicated on the 75th anniversary of the riot. But Tulsa residents did a rare thing. In most places, Americans still have not shown the moral courage to tell what really happened there, let alone offer a hint of apology or rectification. Apologies are more common in Germany. In the Schöneberg quarter of Berlin, for instance, places of remembrance signs detail the regulations that restricted Jewish life in the Third Reich. Signs point out benches that had been marked "No Jews," park areas saying "Jews forbidden," and other benches marked "For Jews only," making graphically clear that the great bulk of Germans knew about and participated in segregating of and discriminating against Jews. The United States needs similar reminders to show how African Americans, and sometimes Native, Mexican, and Asian Americans, were restricted under segregation and by sundown towns. Until about 1968, our monuments pretty much reflected white history. Very few African Americans had been memorialized on our landscape. Almost the only Native Americans we had commemorated were the Tonto figures on our side, Massasoit, who helped the Pilgrims, the Catawbas in South Carolina, who fought with the Confederacy, and above all, Sacagawea, who guided Lewis and Clark. Worst of all, many of the whites our statues lauded were celebrated precisely because they were white supremacists. Then, beginning with Chicago in July 1968, city after city renamed streets after Martin Luther King Jr. Less than 4 months earlier, King had been assassinated. Later, other African Americans got noticed on the landscape, including tennis great Arthur Ashe in Richmond, Virginia, slain NAACP leader Medgar Evers in Jackson, Mississippi, and midwife and philanthropist Biddy Mason in Los Angeles. This we might call inclusionist history, incorporating notable African Americans as success stories, even though some of them had wound up assassinated. The white leadership of some communities deliberately allowed such memorials as a sort of quid pro quo. You don't challenge our monuments and markers, which are downtown, next to City Hall, etc., and we will let you tell your history in your part of town. The first edition of this book noted, in 1999, that merely grafting positive stories about people of color onto our national consciousness is only part of the job that needs to be done. If every group heroifies its past leaders and actions, we still end up honoring boring, perfect heroes while ignoring and forgetting the common history that divides us. For a time, we seemed to be winding up with parallel histories that did not speak to each other. Each group remembered the past in isolation from the others. The past, however, happened only once. In many places, whites have ended up memorializing racists while blacks memorialized anti-racists. The most famous example stands in Virginia, where tennis star and humanitarian Arthur Ashe offsets a host of Confederate leaders on Richmond's Monument Avenue. Such an array of heroes in bronze can only further persuade visitors that whites may be masters of what Germans call Zweckrationalität, technical rationality, but are deficient in Wertrationalität, worth or value rationality. Sociologists use these terms to describe differing human reactions to morally complex situations like slavery and secession. People display Zweckrationalität when they do something well, such as, in this instance, organizing a new nation and fighting effectively, without regard to why. They display Wertrationalität when they act in accord with their basic values. Although monuments and markers about people of color may not challenge the narrative of white supremacy directly, erecting them is imperative. They do tell important stories about the past. Moreover, when they wind up downtown or at interracial institutions, they also desegregate the landscape. Frederick Douglass was the first African American ever to get a monument. Rochester, New York, his hometown, did that in 1899. The 1899 statue remained the only outdoor representation of Douglass until 1989, when Lincoln University of Pennsylvania, a historically black college, put one up, now located near Frederick Douglass Hall, a male dormitory. After 2000, however, new Douglas statues kept foundries busy. Having tea with Susan B. Anthony in Susan B. Anthony Square Park in Rochester in 2001, a huge head on Fells Point in Baltimore in 2006, at Hofstra University on Long Island in 2008, in Decatur, Illinois, with Abraham Lincoln in 2009, on the campus of Hillsdale College, Michigan in 2010, on the grounds of the Talbot County Courthouse in Easton, Maryland in 2010, on Frederick Douglass Plaza in New York City in 2011, outside the New York Historical Society Museum in 2011, and on the main campus of the University of Maryland in 2015. Then in 2018, Rochester topped everywhere else by putting up 13 more outdoor statues of Douglass. These monuments, unlike most memorials and street namings for King, were not confined to the black part of towns. Arthur Ashe does play a desegregative role in Richmond, precisely because he did not wind up in a black neighborhood, where some had proposed to put him. Since his statue went up on Monument Avenue in 1996, the United Daughters of the Confederacy, UDC, no longer celebrates Our President's Day at the Jefferson Davis Monument nearby. Instead, they moved the event to Davis's grave in Richmond's Hollywood Cemetery. Thus, Ashe has changed the UDC's perception of Monument Avenue from our space to neutral space, or even their space. Ashe achieved this influence even though he is not even in sight of Davis, but more than a mile away, with two other Confederate monuments in between. Lauding people of color on our landscape is fine. There is nothing wrong with whites choosing as heroes Martin Luther King Jr. or Sojourner Truth, or Arthur Ashe, for that matter. Nevertheless, it is striking that white students never pick a white abolitionist, civil rights martyr, labor leader, or advocate, like Helen Hunt Jackson for American Indian rights. These pioneers go overlooked on the landscape and in our history textbooks. The whites immortalized on the landscape are mostly famous for actions on the other side, from Jeffrey Amherst through Nathan Bedford Forrest to J. Edgar Hoover. Meanwhile, between 2000 and 2010, neo-Confederates continued to put up new Confederate monuments across the South. Even in 1999, however, citizens were moving beyond mere inclusionist history toward authentic history, hard-hitting monuments and markers that seek to explain, for example, why we have had so few women presidents and governors, rather than just memorializing the few we have had. Examples in race relations include the Civil Rights Museum at the Lorraine Motel in Memphis, the African American Museum in Detroit, Kelly Ingram Park in Birmingham, and the new lynching memorial in Montgomery, described below. The National Museum of African American History and Culture, the new Smithsonian Museum on the National Mall, could have merely taught inclusionist history, showing the lives of successful African Americans throughout our past. It does that, but it also takes on tougher stories, including the lynching of Emmett Till. It also faces some issues that might make African Americans uncomfortable, such as whether the success of black men in the National Basketball Association makes a bad impact on black boys. Some groups have gone through governmental channels to rename sites, chapters 1 and 24, or get corrective plaques installed. In 2003, Native Americans won an evocative new memorial at Little Bighorn Battlefield in Montana. Arizona has put up bilingual historical markers in Apache or Spanish, as well as English. After they got a casino and developed some economic clout, Pequot Indians in Connecticut were able to persuade officials in 1996 to move a statue of John Mason, who commanded the destruction of most of their tribe in 1637, from the massacre site to a less offensive location near his original home. Recently, these efforts have multiplied. I completely revised this book, rather than just adding a new chapter or two, because our public history has advanced so much since 1999, when the first edition came out. Groups that formerly did not have the power to change insulting plaques, even in their own neighborhoods, are now putting up new public history downtown. As a result, our landscape has been enriched by new markers and monuments that not only portray Native American history, African American history, women's history, gay and lesbian history, and the stories of other people and events previously ignored, but also correct errors and omissions in our common history. Just in Mississippi, new museums include the Civil Rights Museum, Medgar Evers' home, Canton Freedom House, and a host of others, and they are popular. Among recent examples of our new willingness to portray real history are accurate treatments of lynching, a hitherto taboo topic. The opening essay in this book noted that lynchings were almost invisible in our public history landscape. In 1999, however, as this book came out, that omission began to get filled in. The Moores Ford Memorial Committee worked with the Georgia Historical Society to put up an accurate state historical marker telling of the last mass lynching in Georgia of two young black married couples, George and May Dorsey and Roger and Dorothy Malcolm, in 1946. Since then, the committee has marked their graves, organized a scholarship contest requiring an essay on race relations, and astonishingly, ritually reenacted the event. In 2003, Duluth, Minnesota, site of the hanging of three black circus workers in 1920, put up an extensive monument to the victims, Elias Clayton, Elmer Jackson, and Isaac McGee. They tried to draw as many spectators to the dedication, 2,500, as attended the lynching itself. And like the Moores Ford Committee, they organized an ongoing scholarship contest requiring an essay, video, poem, or speech about racism. We don't recognize lynching on the landscape for the same reason that the Atlanta History Center would not host the traveling exhibit of lynching photos and postcards, Without Sanctuary, in 2002. For the same reason that the only serious permanent museum exhibit of lynching until 2018, to my knowledge, was at the obscure black-owned Baltimore Museum, Great Blacks in Wax. For the same reason that white parents in Montgomery County, Maryland, objected to school field trips to Great Blacks in Wax. For the same reason that U.S. history textbooks still don't include lynching photographs. We might sum up the stated reasons as white fragility. White children, adults too, might be upset. We can't have that. For that matter, black children might be upset. I first encountered this argument against accurately portraying our history of lynching in federal court back in 1980. The case was Loewen et al. V. Turnipseed et al., prompted by the state of Mississippi's rejection of a Mississippi history textbook I had co-authored, Mississippi, Conflict and Change. John Turnipseed, a member of the Textbook Rating Commission, refused to allow the school system to adopt our book, partly because it had a lynching photo. As lynching photos go, ours was tasteful. In the foreground, in silhouette, a man is being burned. Behind him, well-dressed white men and women pose for the camera. The photo did not show the victim in close-up. No one is hacking parts off his body. Nevertheless, when the Assistant Attorney General for the state of Mississippi asked Turnipseed why he had objected to Conflict and Change, he had the court turn to the page where we discussed lynching. Pointing to the photo, he said, "Now you know some ninth graders are pretty big, especially black male ninth graders. And we worried, or at least I worried, that teachers, especially white lady teachers, would have trouble controlling their classes with material like this in the book." We had pre-tested our book in an overwhelmingly white class.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.